It's a great pleasure to introduce a longtime colleague, both at Veterans Day today and independently, Preston James, PhD, a social psychologist from a Big Ten university, who's going to address the importance of academic research in an era dominated by propaganda from the mass media, where academicians are failing to expose state-sponsored terrorism. He's an expert in this area. Preston, I'm so glad you could join us today.
Well, thanks for having me on, Jim. This is such a huge subject. We could have an ongoing conference for 6 months on this, because if you look at science, you know, medicine, a lot of the contributions that have been made, most of them have started in academia in Europe and Germany and Austria and places like that. That's the force that drives knowledge. And of course, the original term professor, it was a religious term, as you know, that it was basically seminarians professing the truth of God's word, but then they believed that all truth was part of that. Their job was to tell people total truth, scientific truth, truth about God, truth about loving your neighbor, ethics, everything. Of course, that all became secularized. Even the religious schools that were privatized lost all that, and they have, you know, rigid policies. There's no more academic freedom in any of the religious schools at all, the Catholic schools, the Christian schools. They're as dogmatic as you can find. And we'll talk about how that happened, because they were absorbed by Zionism. You know, they've been completely misinformed about Israel and the relationship to Palestine. This idea of the Christian schools, that the Israelis are God's chosen people, and they use the term Jew. Of course, the term Jew wasn't even used in existence until 750 AD. Judah, Judaics, comes from one tribe, one of 12 tribes. And as we know, the 97%+ of the people living in Israel that claim to have ancient heritage to the land, giving them the right to be there, do not. They're Ashkenazis or Khazarian converts to Judaism, you know, between 700 and 1200 AD. You know the story of that. And if anybody wants to know, you can look it up on the internet and get the history. So we have a situation where these Khazarian Ashkenazi Jews, were put into a situation. They were really molded into a race that doesn't exist, believing that they have to breed through their mothers. And it's not true. There is no such Jewish race as such. And even the Khazarians aren't purebred. And so the Holocaust, of course, as you know, made them very paranoid. And they've been all over the world setting up cells of control using every means you can imagine. And we'll talk a little bit about Northfield, you know, what happened down there. Because as you know, Jim, that was a real nightmare that we came through. Okay. So what we have is we have this very powerful group of a very well-organized group of Zionist Jews, but they're really not into the Torah. They're into the Talmud. They're really, you know, they really do not carry the heritage of the early Hebrew people. It's totally different. It's been completely warped. And what we have, these people have usurped power, become very powerful politically. They run the policy institutes. They have hijacked the Pentagon. They've hijacked the government. They've hijacked all of academia, the Christian schools, the secular schools. They're a force behind the media. And you have to ask yourself, why has this one group been able to dominate us and really run terror? Because all terrorism goes back to these people as a driving force. It's all part of their greater Israel plan, as you know, that they have this sinister plan to deploy terror all over the world so that as an excuse to build up and centralize the United States government and use it as a military arm to change the Middle East and to create this greater Israel. That's the dream. It's a psychotic dream, but it's real. So,
Preston, I must say that discovering the difference between Talmudic and Talmudic Judaism was one of the true revelations of my recent life, because, you know, before 2008, when I gave my first political speech during a Ron Paul Freedom Rally on the 15th of April on the grass in front of the Capitol, the concept of Zionism really wasn't functional in my mind. I think that every American has to come to grips with the reality and have the conceptual framework appropriate to understand it.
Well, that's right. And of course, the big question is, why does this group, this artificial group, it's not a racial group. It's really not. Yeah, there's some, it's Ashkenazi stuff, but they're really, it's a mixture of Mongols and Turks and whatever, if you really study it. And there's quite a sinister history to it. And they're very angry. They carry intergenerational anger toward the Russians, toward the Iranians. They blame them for destroying Khazaria. And they really blame, you know, the Gentiles too. So, but you know, they themselves are Gentiles. That's the funny part. They don't know it. So here you have, you know, genetic study done at Johns Hopkins University by a Jewish MD, which you know about, and he comes up with the conclusion 97.5% of the people living in Israel that claim to have ancient blood have no Hebrew blood, come from Europe, and 80% of the Palestinians that live there do have ancient Hebrew blood and actually have ties, legal ties, to all the land. And there was no right for anybody to steal their land.
Just a comment on that, if I might, Preston.
Yeah.
We've just had a conversation with Kevin McDonald, who's done a great deal about the Jewish group strategy of inbreeding and, you know, benefiting themselves while encouraging other countries to become multicultural and to lose their own distinctive identity. But it seemed to me that Kevin was not convinced that the people who are occupying the lands of Israel actually aren't derivative from Judea. I'm convinced they are, and you cite the DNA studies from Johns Hopkins, which seem to me to be decisive.
Yeah.
While the term being a Semite is a linguistic distinction,
and
it applies to all the Arab lands, it turns out that those who are occupying Israel, ironically, are by and large not Semitic, but got to be the greatest practitioners of anti-Semitism in the world.
Well, that's right. They're two-faced. And the thing is you probably don't know this, but recently there was a top secret document in Israel where it was admitted that they have no Hebrew blood. They've admitted it to themselves, and that's why they wanted to go back and take the Ukraine. That's why Victoria Nuland went in there and staged the coup to put Poroshenko.
Because that is the country of their origin, the region of their origin.
And Poroshenko, they put him in. And of course, that's failing. You know, he had that very strong, and Ukraine had this huge business with tourism and tremendous tourism trade, which has been destroyed. So the country's going broke. But so if you look at this group, this every country in the world where these Judaics have been, they've been kicked out one way or another. And there's a whole lot of secret history about World War II. None of it is the way we've been told, as you know. And so we'll talk a little bit about that. But what I wanted to do is investigate, find out why these well-organized Jewish groups, there's a worldwide network of them, why they have so much power. They have access to Mossad intel files. Mossad has access. All of our NSA files are downloaded to Israel, Tel Aviv, by satellite. They have full access to all the NSA raw feeds. But what Israel doesn't know is they've been completely penetrated by Russian intel. The KGB, you know, set up Israel as their slave state. A lot of people don't realize it's the Bolsheviks that, you know, that staged the revolution in Russia in 1917, were financed by the British bankers, as were the Nazis. You know, and of course, you know that Hitler was a British agent the whole time. He was mind-controlled at Tavistock Institute. So the core problem always goes back to these Zionist bankers who really, they themselves are not Hebrew either. Most of them are German, but they're the great impersonators. But they played the role as a Hofjuden. They're the Vatican bankers, and they've gained a lot of power over the world. But basically what happens is they are the cutouts for the old black nobility families in Europe that really run things. These are the unspeakable families people do not dare talk about. It's very hard to get their names. If you do searches on the internet, they're there. They run things behind the lines. But basically where their money comes from, they own all the financial businesses and the big corporations. And the reason that these large corporations are so interested in starting wars is because they make money off wars, the defense contractors. And, of course, you know the big banks lend money to everybody. And if you look at what empowers the Zionists are nothing but cutouts. They're empowered by the private central bankers, the Rothschild banking system. The United States is a franchisee of it. The Federal Reserve is nothing but a franchise of it. People in the United States are being completely defrauded financially. In 1913, they passed the Federal Reserve Act, which is completely illegal, completely unconstitutional, Jim. And we're in a situation where they created real money, which is silver and gold-backed certificates, and they got rid of those bit by bit. 1971, Henry Kissinger, who's part of this Khazarian Mafia, which we'll talk about, which is the world's largest organized crime syndicate that is what the banksters really are. And because Henry Kissinger conned Richard Nixon into dropping the gold standard and the silver standard and went strictly to a paper dollar Federal Reserve note, there's nothing behind it anymore, as you know. Okay, but the deal was we made a contract with all the Mideast oil producers that we would provide protection for them through Israel and through NATO if they would promise that they would never accept anything but a U.S. dollar for oil. So now, that's up the United States dollar as a world exchange currency. But basically, our government's been printing so much, it's been watering everything down. The rest of the world right now, China, Russia, and many, many other nations are building huge financial firewalls against the United States to destroy the Federal Reserve and destroy the U.S. dollar, and it is coming. So, you know about the BRICS, the AIIB, the Chinese have set up their own electronic SWIFT, money transfer system, and then you have the new Silk Road development, which they're going to run this railroad all the way from China through Russia to the Mideast and then to Europe, and it's going to totally revolutionize. All the power is going to shift to that area, Eurasia. That's why Brzezinski had the great chessboard plan where he wanted to go over there and take this over. He's recently announced he's abandoned it. That Russia basically checkmated the Khazarian Mafia in Israel in the Mideast. All these wars in the Mideast wars were all staged. None of them were justified. They were all based on lies, false premises. Okay, so if you want to understand why there is absolutely no academic freedom of any kind. And that's my hypothesis tonight, and I'm going to tell you why. My research technique that I use, I don't know if I've ever talked about this, but I do participant observation. I go get involved at every level. And so that's the only way you really find out what's going on the street. And I've infiltrated all kinds of stuff that I won't talk about. Well, we have, you remember President Woodrow Wilson, the guy that signed the Federal Reserve Act in 1913. In his book that was published in 1913, it's called The New Freedom. There's a quote which is very important. He said, since I entered politics, I have had men's views confided to me privately. Some of the biggest men in the U.S. in the field of commerce and manufacturing are afraid of somebody, are afraid of something. They know that there is a power somewhere so organized, so subtle, so watchful, so interlocked, so complete, so pervasive that they better not speak above their breath when they speak in condemnation of it. He was talking about the banksters. They have a worldwide organization, the Rothschild. They have their own intelligence. They hire all kinds of agents. They specialize in murder by knife, gun, poison, all kinds, setting up accidents. You know, they were the original founders of Arkansas, making murders look like natural deaths. So really, all of the intelligence agents in the world were basically financed by this private central banking system, the Rothschilds. In the United States, all our intelligence agencies were set up under the British model, like the intrepid Sir William Stevenson came over and set most of them up, and they all answered originally to the British intelligence system, the Queen. And technically, we're still operating under that model. But these intelligence agencies, like the CIA, the FBI, the U.S. Treasury, they all work for the banksters, and they're there to protect their interests. So we really have a cabal of banksters creating money from nothing, charging us usury, pernicious usury to use our own money, which, of course, is illegal in many of the Islamic countries, and that's why they want to destroy them. They go after any country that will not use their banking. You know, and so that's what starts basically the wars. Two things: destroy the fiat banking, so they have to use Rothschild banking. That starts the war. Or if any country is becoming too powerful, like Libya was developing a gold coin system for all of Africa, they had a water system that was going to revolutionize. It was going to turn into one of the greenest countries in the world. People were happy. Gaddafi. Was taking care of young people, health care, you know the story. He was doing a good job, so they had to get rid of him. It was Hillary Clinton that did that, of course.
I remember how stunned I was when the reports came out that the first act of the alleged rebel group in Libya was to found a new central bank. Right. And Hillary's emails, the ones being declassified, have revealed the actual reasons for the attack on Libya have nothing to do with Gaddafi abusing the people, as you're implying. On the contrary, is sharing the wealth of the nation with them, national health care, public education, warehouses stocked with food. Anyone with a health problem that couldn't be dealt with in Libya would be flown anywhere in the world, all expense paid by the government. But rather, because Western banking interests, read that Rothschild, were upset with the gold dinar, and that the French wanted to preserve their influence over Africa as their neo-colonial preserve.
Exactly. Now, here's the thing. This network we're talking about, the Israeli firsters that control the universities, they control the policy boards, they control the academic curriculum totally in the private schools, in the public universities, and in even the religious universities. They control it all, and they do it through various ways. And we ran into it head on down in Northfield, Minnesota. And we're going to talk about that in a minute and how we dealt with that. And what we uncovered there when we ripped the thing open, it went all the way back to Israel, Jim, as you know. So, but the reason these groups have this power is because, and you would think here they are working against the interests of the United States, they should really be arrested. They should have to register as a foreign agent group. All these people that harassed you down at Northfield should have been arrested right there, but they're not. So you have to ask yourself why. Why can somebody like Dr. Kevin Barrett, be sanctioned for doing nothing wrong, you know, or other professors that are continually being fired for speaking up? Why is there no academic freedom when you have these people that are actually going against the rules, that are doing things in their classes that are against the United States? See, the thing is if you do something that's politically correct nowadays, politically correct is really bolshevism. It's against the interests of the people. If you teach that pornography is great, and if you teach that any kind of deviance is good, and anything that breaks down the society, then it's fine. You can, you know, I remember when I went to a university, we had a communist professor there, and he would say all kinds of horrible things during the Vietnam War, no problem at all. And yet if the kids protested the war, you know, they would be sanctioned or kicked out of school, but he could do anything he wanted because he was a Bolshevik and because he was Jewish. I thought that was very strange. See? So if you support what the establishment wants, if you have a role that favors the establishment, say, well, how do these groups that go around and control and suppress any kind of free discussion, like these Jewish groups that go around and prevent any discussion of false flag terror, Sandy Hook being a hoax, Boston bombing being a fake false flag, all these fake shootings, or the real ones that are real actual mind control? Why don't they want any of that discussed? You would think that if they were true Americans and citizens that cared about this country, they want it discussed, but they're not. They're dual citizens, and they actually favor Israel first, and they see it very important to fulfill these policies that our establishment hierarchy wants, because that way they're empowered. You know, so what we have is we have enforcement of these policies set on what curriculum is going to be. All university curriculum is set by policy boards, private policy boards that have meetings. I'm not going to give you the names of them, but they're almost all linked to Jewish, these dual citizens, and PNAC and all the top neocons. They're all involved in setting educational policy. It actually goes back, if you want to really get technical about it, to the early 1900s, when they wanted to centralize education and run it out of Washington so that they could control it. That's what they're doing. So there is no academic freedom. You slip through the cracks. I remember up in Duluth when you started. If you'd been down at the main campus in Minnesota, they would have jumped on you for some of the stuff you did at the end of your career. In their view, your investigations were outrageous. Now, of course, I was one of the first people to get hold of your book, that first one you wrote, Assassination Science. I was so shocked by it that a professor could do a scientific study. And, of course, the first objection would be is, some professor can't know anything about covert operations stuff. You see, but your answer was, you right up front said, here's what I can do. and here's what I can't do in the areas you weren't didn't specialize in. You brought in the top specialists. So it was impossible to criticize because you had the top forensic guys, top medical guys, you know, and you put it all together. Now, that had never been done. I was shocked. So I called you up on the phone, talked to you. I said, this is fantastic, you know. And so then the other two came out. I call it the trilogy. But those three books, nobody had ever done a scientific study. I mean, I like Jim Marr's work. I like all of that, you know. But, and you know, there's been other people, but no one ever did a scientific study. And the thing about your stuff was it totally, absolutely shredded the, you know, it shredded the government cover-up, totally. So we ended, I ended up with two things from your books. Number one, the government, the CIA did it. And I found out later, I, you know, talked to people involved. I know who did it. I found out that the government covered it up. I found out the government's still covering up. I think the research you did that shocked me the most, the two things was the fake brain x-rays, which, you know, you had the top medical expert in the world that helped you with that. And the other thing was, is the Pruder film being so fake. When you start looking at how much fakery was done in this Pruder film, two things are obvious. One, they did a terrible job, and two, they didn't care. They were so arrogant, they just didn't care. So much of this was slop work, and it's easy to discover if you have the right people. Well, see, you brought in, what, some film expert from Australia. You had some of the top eggheads in this stuff around, and your research is bulletproof, see? So I think, for me, that changed my whole orientation to it, because before it, I'd try to reason through it, but then I realized you can go after this stuff scientifically. You can use reasoning and of course, because you taught logic for so many years, when people would try to intercept you and shut you down using the various things like straw man arguments, like, you're on to every single one of them. You'd rip them a new one in seconds. So I always enjoyed it. So the reason we have no academic freedom is because all academic curriculum is set by policy boards, hidden boards in smoke-filled rooms in D.C. and New York City and Chicago. And they decide what can be talked about or not. So you will never have any classes on the Federal Reserve Bank, fiat money, why it's not real money, and how come they get to charge us interest for doing nothing, and why? Who are the owners of the Federal Reserve? Why are they all foreign-based families? Why is that? See, you'll never have a class on that, or false flag attacks, or Sandy hoax. You'll never have a class, or you'll never have a class on deep black covert operations, or Dulce, New Mexico underground base. You'll never have any of that. See, these are the most important subjects we have, or the Vietnam War, why it was fake, or you'll never have a class on why Ho Chi Minh, one of our biggest allies in World War II, whom we shipped weapons to during the whole war against the Japanese, was totally trustworthy, turned on him at the end, divided Vietnam into two countries, shipped weapons to the South, and started the war, just like we did in Korea. You'll never have a class on that, Jim. See, it's not allowed. So you'll never have a class on the influence of Zionism, the cutouts for the bankers. The reason the Zionists have so much power in this country is because they do the dirty work of the banksters. The banksters like them. They're the front people for them. You know, they maintain their system for them. And they're greatly rewarded for it, too, financially. They get the game is, the people that really run things, I call them the establishment hierarchy. There's probably, you can count them on a handful. I call them wrinkled up old guys in wheelchairs, or this select few. They make these decisions. You have everything is organized into a pyramidal hierarchy, and you maybe have one or two or three people at the top that call the shots. Whatever they say is law. Some guy has a bad day, fights with his wife or his kids, and he thinks, damn it, we're going to get rid of all the guns. And he calls up his lieutenant and says, that's it, new policy, no more guns in America. So then they immediately, okay, they go to the Federal Reserve, the U.S. Treasury, they maybe go to black drug operations, but they appropriate maybe $20 billion, and they hire NGO groups to go to every state. They hire lobbyists. The whole machinery comes into play because one guy had a bad day, had a fight with his wife, and decided to set a new policy. Now, I know that sounds stupid, but that's how it works. And you know I've had contacts with people very high up, and this is what I find out, that it's very banal. How these policies are set have no rhyme or reason to them. They have certain key agendas, like anything that will help globalize the world, take away our national sovereignty, they'll approve. So what the people that are running our government are doing it on the basis of policies that have been set by these top policy guys. And what they want is they want to degrade the United States, convert it into a third world nation like Mexico. They've signed secret agreements. Their secret clauses in every trade agreement, like NAFTA, had secret clauses where they said the United States, Canada, and Mexico are one state, and that's why we're not going to enforce the borders. Now, they're still enforcing them with Canada, but they're not allowed to enforce them with Mexico. Part of the secret clauses are the sanctuary cities. This has all been signed and agreed to. So in order for us to get rid of this, we have to get rid of the people making these policies, which is the Khazarian Mafia top officials. Anybody who wants to know that can study it. In the last 2 years, we've broken it all open for the first time. Normally, 3 years ago, if you even mentioned the word Khazarian Mafia, you'd have been dead by the next day. They'd send somebody out and shoot you right in your bed. That's how much they wanted to keep it quiet. Now it's an open secret. The Khazarian Mafia is being attacked by all sides. As you know, Putin has been a strong ally of Syria and Iran for years. Neither country started any war for many years. I think 200 years for Iran, isn't it? I don't know how many for Syria. And of course, Iran was attacked by Iraq at our bequest because we, you know, used Saddam as a puppet. That was another Israeli operation. But what happens is these policymakers appoint doofuses at every level in the government. They control the elections. They fake the voting. They vote dead people. They do. John Kennedy actually lost the election to Richard Nixon. Richard Nixon was furious. But the reason that everybody liked Kennedy so much is because he went against the grain. The mob supported him in Chicago. They thought he was going to take care of them. He didn't. He put Bobby in there as U.S. Attorney General. Bobby turned on all of them. And that's one of the reasons they wanted to assassinate him. They did all kinds of things to dirty him up and entrap him. And as many ways as they compromised Jack Kennedy, you know, he was still a good president. He was always a true American right to the very end. So that's what we need. People are hoping Trump might be like this. I don't know. We don't know. It's too soon, but, you know, we'll just have to wait and see. But the Khazarian Mafia is under fire. So when the Americans created ISIS, as you know, it's strictly an American Central Intelligence Agency mercenary force supported by Israel, supported by Turkey, supported by Saudi Arabia, financed a lot by Saudi Arabia. It's completely artificial. When we went over there and they have these training camps, they pick up street urchins off the street, like in Saudi Arabia, little kids that are abandoned, take them in training camps, and they mind control them for 15 years, show them all kinds of movies. And you know, they're complete zombies by the time they're done with them. And they will blow themselves up. They will do anything they're told. That's what they create. So the mercenaries come in and train them and run them. Well, of course, the plan was to get rid of Syria, take it Syria down, then use that as a stepping stone, get rid of Iran. They're not afraid of Iran for nukes. They're afraid of Iran because they're so strong. And the Israelis hate the Persians. They want to get rid of them. So when that happened, of course, Putin has billions and billions of dollars invested in Iran and Syria, and he came to their defense. He was invited to help Assad. He went in there under international law legally and helped him. Now, the United States is in Syria right now. They have no legal right to be there. They never had any legal right to be in Iraq or any place. You know. So basically what happened was Putin's military has pounded him, and he's got special ops on the ground. He's got air power there. He's got cruise missiles. He's got everything. And he literally has pounded ISIS. Another month or two, they're not even going to exist. So what you have is you have a situation where now the United States is starting to bomb ISIS to look good to the world. And so the United States has turned it into a disposal operation where they're killing their own. All these CIA mercenaries and these special op guys are all going to be murdered. None of them are probably going to come out of their alive because the current administration won't allow that. We always kill our black ops when we're done. And it's getting to the point now where people know SEAL Team 6, they were murdered. So this is the kind of people you have determining educational policy. That's why there isn't any. Now, I'd like to get into Northfield, if I can, just to give a good example. And we're going to talk about operational realities. And you know, I was right there, so people can say whatever they want. I was there. Okay, as you know, when you come to Minnesota, there's some pretty serious people here that take care of your protection, as you know. Jim, you know that, right? We watch out for you up here. And I'm not talking little babies. I'm talking some pretty tough individuals. Okay, so when you went to Northfield, we'd done, you know, intelligence work. We scoped the place out for the entrances and everything and, you know, the whole usual stuff. And we had, I was part of that three-man team, as you remember.
Just to provide a sketch for the audience, Preston, I was invited to come to Northfield as part of a series being organized by the owner of a bar called the Contented Cow, Norman Butler. He wanted me to speak about Sandy Hook, about the Boston bombing, about JFK, about 9/11. And I was immediately assailed as a Holocaust denier by members of the faculty and staff at St. Olaf's College and at Carleton, which was incredible, given that they both have a reputation for being liberal arts colleges where you should be open to freedom of expression, freedom of research, freedom of inquiry. But they undertook a campaign of vilification against me. And eventually the atmosphere became so threatening that Norman Butler had to call it off because his staff, his own staff, felt such a sense of anxiety. Now, in this
context, they threatened to ruin his business, though. They threatened to ruin his business.
Oh, yeah, they did, absolutely. It was completely outrageous. So Kevin Barrett thought this was outrageous and we ought to do something about it. And because he has a nonprofit, he was able to contact the library to obtain a conference room for me to speak. So I came to Northfield, nevertheless, in spite of all the animosity, which had become a huge subject of discussion in the local newspaper and elsewhere, and spoke on Sandy Hook at the Boston bombing at the conference room in the library. This is the event of which you speak and the background against which it occurred.
Which Dr. Kevin Barrett set up, which was, set up the, actually, what it was, the Israeli Islamic Alliance.
Yeah,
I don't want to give the impression that you know all Jews in this country are screwballs. No, actually, it's a small minority of them, but they're dangerous individuals, and we'll talk about why. But there's right now there's a big split in the Jewish community. A lot of the American Jews are sick of all of Netanyahu and all this like CUDA stuff, and this boycott, divest, sanction is created a huge split. Even in the Mossad, there's people in the Mossad turning against them. But so we get down to Northfield, and we did a complete security check. We had the whole thing scoped out, and we had people down there helping us, too, watching people coming in and typing them and everything. So I end up sitting next to these guys, which gave up a lot of nonverbals. You can tell by people how they get nonverbal signals and get off that they're deceptive. So I sat next to this guy. It turns out he was a college professor from one of these colleges you're talking about, supposedly a Christian college. Okay, he has two guys there with him. One is runs a security system at one of the universities. The other guy is an IDF guy, a Mossad agent. He's got three students, and he's got one old guy about 70 years old, and they're sitting there huddling before the thing. But what he didn't understand is I was sitting right behind him, and I had a hat on, and I had very good hearing. The hat was pushing my ears for it, so I could hear every word. And he's saying, okay, now what we got to do is this Fetzer guy, he's a Holocaust denier, but he's not here to talk about it, but we got to draw him out. So what we got, first thing we got to do is, you, Max, you got to stand, this old guy, you stand up and ask stupid questions and waste time and all this kind of stuff. And after he gets frustrated, wait till he's frustrated. We're going to screw up his electronic stuff. We've got somebody who's got the audio-visual stuff remote controlled. We'll take care of that. So-and-so's got that covered. Turns out that guy was an expert in that. Okay, as you know.
I couldn't get my computer to work.
No. But they were doing that through the Wi-Fi.
I could only get an old program to play on someone else's computer, Preston.
Because they were working your computer through the Wi-Fi. I heard them talking about how are they going to do this. Okay, so then the guy says, you bring up this. And at the end, when he's angry, when he's real frustrated because the thing is his computer won't work and this, he said, and the one guy says, well, I might be able to keep him from even having any visuals. And that'll really frustrate him. So then when you see him really getting angry, then you bring up the Holocaust, and he's whispering to him what to say. And he says, if we can get him angry, we get him to blow a fuse and make him look stupid, then it'll ruin the film so nobody will believe him. He'll discredit himself. He said, that's all we have to do. All we got to do is discredit him, and our job is done. And he was part of this local Jewish organization. Now, they had a rabbi there, too, even worse. Okay, so he's sitting there, getting ready. I'm sucking this all in, watching him. Plus, we had another guy over there that was following you, that was armed, stalking you that night. Remember that?
Yes.
Okay.
You pointed him out to me. I wasn't aware until you made the option.
And he was trying to follow you to his car. We had to take care of him on the way out of there. And, he didn't get to your car, did he?
No.
Okay. He didn't get anywhere after that, did he? No. Okay, so then these guys are talking, and this old guy, well, first of all, you can't get your thing to work, and you're frustrated and stuff. And, you know, whatever they did, they got in through the Wi-Fi. That's what he said he was going to do. So they KO'd the program. But you got around, you got one of the older ones working somehow,
yes.
Right?
Yes.
Okay. And it was still pretty good. Okay, so then this old guy stands up and starts going on and on and on. And I nudged him in the shoulder. I said, sit down and shut up. You've had your say. So then he sat down. Okay, and then they started in on you. You know, you got through the most of the presentation, but they tried to interrupt him. I'd tell him to shut up. We want to hear this, you know. And finally, the guy in front of me looks at me hard, and I tell him, listen, buddy, let him talk. This is his time. So then they started getting a little scared. And then I had that one other guy, that's 250 pounds, and he's so mean you don't even want to look at him, you know. He'll pull your teeth out with his fingernails. So he started eyeing him up and all this kind of stuff. And I got the idea to let him talk. So they backed off completely. Now, when we were down in Mayo and we had security for you down there, you remember they pulled the same stuff on you? That was some of the same people, same students. You remember how they started asking you questions?
I don't recall that at all.
They had two guys in the back. You're part of this Jewish organization. And they started asking you questions about the Holocaust and all this. And I went over there and told them to shut up, and they did.
You want to hear something ironic, Preston, is when they finally did ask me about the Holocaust, I was extremely explicit. I said, what I explicitly deny is that 6 million Jews were put to death in gas chambers using Zyklon B. And would you believe when it was later written about in the local paper, they said Fetzer was very vague about where he stood on the Holocaust. I mean, I could not have been more explicit.
No, but you said a lot more than that. You said it was a horrible thing, these people being kidnapped and put in these work camps and dying in them and all this. And you said even if the Red Cross figures of 190-some thousand were true, that's a horrible, horrible thing.
296.81.
Whatever, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah, so they totally twisted the whole thing. But here's the interesting part. When we get out of there, we sift through all the stuff. When all the intel finally comes in, it turns out that we ID all these people, but we find out they got a Mossad cell down there. About that time, I had a friend of mine. He wasn't a real close friend. He was a friend of mine who was murdered. He was in a militia in southern Minnesota right after they started, these people moved in. This IDF Mossad guy comes in. He's murdered, okay? A little bit later, there's his family up in Bloomington, Minnesota. The guy that was producing the movie Gray State, murdered.
Yeah.
There's 12 murders after this crew comes in. They're all, I thought they were all linked to these people myself. We had no murders or any of this stuff until they came into town. Now, for them to be this rigid, where they are working the local media, they're threatening a bar restaurant owner that never heard a flea in his life, telling them they're going to shut his business down also because he has to talk. You never even mentioned anything about the Holocaust to this guy that owned the restaurant.
Right.
These people are so paranoid, they were inventing, confabulating all this crap in their mind. So they were in there. It was like life or death situation for them.
What has to be emphasized is we're talking about people on the staff and faculty at St. Olaf College and Carleton.
Which is supposed to be Christian religious schools.
Liberal arts school.
Yeah. But they're supposed to have Christian philosophy of, freedom, all this kind of stuff. No. But the point I'm trying to make is these were desperate people in there, and they were working hard to try to screw you up. So there is no academic freedom outside of the university. And, there's hundreds of cases just in the last year. And there is no academic freedom inside the university. And as a graduate student, I can tell you there's no academic freedom. The only academic freedom I had was with my advisor. And that's because he was a good guy. But he told me there was no academic freedom. He told me, if you want to get out of this place, you have to do this, 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 and this. You have to keep your mouth shut about this. You can talk to me, but you can't talk about this.
Preston, I've been fascinated by your comparison of the Duluth campus and the Twin Cities. Now, it happened when I was doing the research on JFK that there was an associate dean in the graduate school who loved my work on JFK. And I think that gave me a certain buffer on the Twin Cities campus. But when I founded Scholars for 9/11 Truth in December of 2005, which was only 6 months before I would retire the following June, they might not have been as receptive for my, digging in to a whole other area and bringing together, again, a whole lot of experts to study it.
Well, Jim, I'll guarantee you that if you had been up there and gotten into Sandy Hook, I don't care if it had been, you know, the main campus in Minneapolis or the Duluth campus, you'd have been out of there so fast, it'd been unbelievable, even if you didn't bring it into your classes. Because there's a new policy, Homeland Security goes around and delivers these NSL letters, these national security letters, and they put people on no work lists. And if you're going to cover a topic like that, they will go talk to faggots, say, this guy's a suspected terrorist. You got to get rid of him. We'll help you find a phony excuse. You cannot tell them the truth or you'll go to jail for 10 years. They let them read the letter. They take the letter back. We have witnesses how this is done. We know people are involved in it. So, yeah, there is no academic freedom. Right now, anywhere in the country, if you even if you're a professor and if you teach this stuff on the outside, and if you're a small time, you might have tenure, but they'll get rid of you one way or the other. If you're a really big name person, they might leave you alone. But it's, you know, the thing is, it's starting to break, though. The Khazarian Mafia is falling apart. You know that I personally think we're going to go over a financial cliff sometime in the next period of months. And when the U.S. petrodollar dies, a lot of the prices are going to go up.
Hey, Preston, have you, on September 30th, China, the renminbi, the yuan that's going to join the reserve currency?
Right, yes.
The dollar. Have you looked into that?
Well, I was told that they're trying to downplay this, saying it's going to be a part of this special drawing rights, like a basket of currencies. But what it really means is the U.S. petrodollar will no longer be the main reserve currency of the world. It'll still be there acceptable, but it's being pushed out nicely. Because, see, the reason the Chinese don't just drop it all is because they own tons of our debt. And if the value drops too fast, they'll get nothing. So what they're doing is they're buying up real estate in the United States like crazy, and they're buying gold and silver. But they're afraid of an immediate collapse, too, because if the stock market goes down too fast, they're going to lose their shirts, too.
Does the U.S. actually have gold, physical gold reserves? Is that, what's the inside on that?
Well,
is Fort Knox empty?
Yeah.
Fort Knox is empty. Well, no, that's not exactly true. There's gold in Fort Knox, but it's tungsten-filled gold.
Okay.
It's gold-plated tungsten bars.
I think it's, yeah, it, you know, it has the same density as gold, right. And you know about the big scandal where they shipped a bunch of U.S. mint stuff to China about 3-4 years ago, and the Chinese drilled through it, and it was fake, and they're furious. So I think there was a huge gold stash in the Twin Towers, you know, where the gold was taken out. Yeah. Claimed that it was lost, and they collected on the insurance for it. I have conservative Christian friends who tell me, yeah, it's good to have a little gold and silver, but they believe the Bible prophecy where it says a bushel full of gold and silver won't buy a loaf of bread. I mean, they've already suppressed the price of gold and silver down to probably 1/5 of what it should be. You know, they have that's set in London, and the London bankers are in a quandary now because you know, they're losing money too. The Chinese have been buying up all this gold, and one of these days, if the world shifts over to a new monetary system based on gold and silver and platinum and resources like corn and grain and things like that, bankers are going to be screwed.
You know, there's another thing going on, is that the Federal Reserve has kept interest rates too low, and yeah, they're actually going to raise rates into a recession. That's got to be a sign that things are falling apart, you know?
Well, that's right. But see, the thing is in the last recession, 2008, older people lost 40, the middle class and the older people lost 40% of their net wealth, 40%, and that did not come back. So there are a lot of people that lost 50, 60%, but most of it came back. But there are people that actually across the board lost 40% of their wealth. But because of the advanced mind control using the TV and all these waveforms and stuff, people have been put to sleep. You know, and one of their main strategies is to stress everybody from every direction possible, financially, job, this and that. So you're fighting so many battles, you don't have time to think about that. Look at what happened after 2008 when the interest rates in the banks dropped down to about 0%, a little, maybe 0.01 or something. Old people up to that time had saved all their lives and were living off the interest off their accounts. Now they're spending down the principal. There is no interest coming in and off their accounts. So there's been a remarkable drop in the standard of living. You have old people going back to work. The government wants to drive people out of their homes. They have this 2021. Have you ever heard of that? This Agenda 21.
Yes.
And under Agenda 21, there will be no suburbs. You want everybody living in the city in 10 by 16 metal cartons stacked up, you know, like little tiny, like Japanese apartments. And they want to bulldoze all of the suburbs out, turn them into nature areas. So the real thing is they want to get depopulate the area so they can take the wood for forestry, take the natural resources. It's the same old thing. The Khazarian Mafia, every place they go, they start these wars. They destroy any country that's doing well. And then, you know, as a means to thin the herd, kill as many as they can. And of course, they have esoteric reasons why they like a lot of human suffering and death. But then they go in there and get all the natural resources for pennies on the dollar or nothing and share it with their crony corporate friends. So war is the best book on this was, of course, War is a Racket by Smedley Butler, General Smedley Butler, the most decorated war hero ever had, had two Medal of Honors. He was a Marine general. He told the truth. He couldn't do it anymore. He said that the corporations were using the military to make money and protect their interests, and still doing it. So, you know, we haven't had it. Even World War II was orchestrated. There was really no need for that. We built the Japanese up, built them into a military state to make money. The bankers did, and then they cut them off. The bankers started the Bolshevism. The bankers started Nazism. The bankers started Maoism. All these isms are started by them. The Soviet Union was a big experiment. It failed. So what they've been doing is using these dictator-type ships as an experiment to find out what's working. And the model they're using us now is a derivative based on artificial intelligence, where they've calculated all this out using multiple regression, come up with the ideal. They game everything. They have like a million different world situations going on different computers at the same time, and they game them all with different inputs, and they come up with the best composite. So basically, we're living in a completely managed situation.
And Preston, I have to say, this is not kind of information you get from academic institutions today. If anything, they're suppressing, they're giving an illusory impression of the way the world is together. You just cannot get this kind of truth from academic institutions, from professors, for all the kinds of reasons you've been suggesting.
Well, I 4 years ago, I wouldn't have said any of the stuff that I'm saying tonight. It would have been an instant death sentence for anybody. Now the whole thing's coming undone. They aren't doing that anymore. And now the intelligence agencies have turned against them. There's a split in the intelligence agency. Intelligence agents from all over the world are working together to destroy the Khazarian Mafia. There, all these leaks coming out are quite interesting. They can't stop. I just wanted to talk about the difference between fascism and super fascism. Now, basically, as you know, when we privatized the banking, Andrew Jackson fought it and stuff, but in 1913, banking in the United States, which is the creation of money and the distribution of it, was privatized. That's a very dangerous precedent. The bankers have a plan to privatize everything. So under George Bush, under all these various presidents, and Ronald Reagan did this too. He had this one executive order, 12333, which gave him the right to privatize things as the agents of national security. So during World War II, the tobacco corporations are privatized under national security. All these international corporations have all been privatized. Microsoft was privatized. Microsoft was going their own way and was very careful with security for their users. And of course, the intelligence agencies went to him and said, listen, you're going to give us back doors. You're going to put back doors in all your software. And Gates said, no, I'm not. He said, oh, yes, you are. And he said, no, I'm not. So he left. About a month later, he gets sued in about 100 different courts for under the antitrust laws. Then they go back in, drop down their business card and say, you want to talk about how you're going to help us with back doors? Because we can get the monkey off your back. We can stop it all tonight. I guess maybe we can work something out. That's why Microsoft went bad. That's what they do to everybody. Of course, it's the old thing. So, you know, it's silver or lead. You know, the typical thing is they pull a contract out of one pocket. They set down a bullet, 50 caliber bullet on the other side of the desk. They said, now, I just work for these people. I don't do this. But here's what they're telling me is you can sign this contract, get all this money to build this and be our boy. You can become one of ours. Or you can get this lead when you least expect it.
An offer they cannot refuse.
They really do that, see? Okay, so what happened in fascism, which World War II, of course, it happened earlier in Japan, but fascism is the merger of the state with the corporation. But regular fascism is where the state and the corporation are merged, but the state maintains control and runs the corporations for the political reasons of the state. There's the ultimate power lies with the state and the leader of the state. Super fascism is different. It's more sinister because with super fascism, you have the merger of the state and the corporation, but the corporation takes over the state and takes on the functions of the state and puts people in power in the state. It builds the state from its own revolving door people, so the state is nothing but corporate, it's stacked with corporate people. Now, that's what happened. We have no elected officials in this country anymore that represent the people. They all work for the state. As you know, like Cynthia McKinney said, if you're elected into Congress, you get a little visit from a representative of AIPAC. They have a little contract with all the fine print stuff. Basically, look, you know, we want you to join the team. Everybody else comes in there. They sign this agreement to put Israel first, even before the United States. But our interests are the same as yours, so it's not a problem. You sign this thing. We will make sure you get reelected. And that's why incumbents are reelected 97% of the time. But we're going to make sure. But what if I don't sign it? You don't want to know. You know, you don't want to know. Go find out what's happening to people who didn't sign it. So Cynthia McKinney said, no, I'm not signing it. She didn't. And of course, they redistricted. They spent millions of dollars getting an opponent that would take her out. They have all the money they want. They just go to the Federal Reserve, say, give me $15 billion. We get, you know. No problem. And if they don't have enough to do that, they sell drugs. The CIA is the biggest drug dealer in the world. You know, if the drug laundering, the drug money laundering business was cut off, every major bank in Wall Street would go under in 1 month. And I got this from a high-ranking DEA guy. Anybody that wants to know about this can just get the book Underground Empire. Dennis Dale ran Centec. It was so successful, every drug operation led to the CIA, but they shut it down. He would have put them all out of business. So basically, with super fascism, you have everything privatized. The corporations are running everything, but yet it's all through these doofuses they appoint in the government. So we think we can go to the government, elect new people in the government, tell them what they're going to do. All this has no effect because they're taking orders from these corporate heads like the Pilgrim Society, Council on Foreign Relations, all these privatized trilateral commissions. They're taking orders from these people to run these policy boards from that. So it's all totally deniable. If you go to these people and say, hey, quit wrecking our country, say, I don't know what you're talking about. Go talk to the president. He runs everything. The president doesn't run anything. Okay, so it's very sinister. Now, it gets even worse. They've privatized defense. You know, so it used to be the draft. People got drafted. That's why we had the protests for the Vietnam War. So they figured this is no good. We can't have people rioting the streets. You know, in Vietnam, you know about the rebellion that took place in Saigon in that one barracks with the blacks. We're tired of being, you know, cannon fodder, and they rebelled. And they actually had shootouts with their MPs and stuff. And they just said, we're not fighting anymore. And you know about the fragging. There were hundreds of officers fragged in Vietnam. They tried to cover that up, but these new lieutenants are coming out of West Point and saying, we're going out tomorrow, we're going to get those Kong, and you're going to be point man. You know, they told us, sorry, we're going to rotate evenly, you're going to be point man. That guy said, no, we're not. We've been here, we're going home in a couple weeks, and we don't want to get killed. We know what it takes to be alive at this fire base. And the guy said, no, you're going to follow orders. At night while he's sleeping, somebody slips by, drops a grenade under his bed, boom. Oh, he got hit with a mortar. That happened to hundreds of them. Because the whole thing, when they know that they'd lost total control. That's why they ended the war. Nobody wanted to fight anymore. It was ridiculous. So Nixon goes in there and bombs them all stuff. That wasn't even working. So basically the war was lost at home. And, of course, you know, Timothy Leary was giving out free LSD and everything. The whole deal with drugs and LSD was to try to demotivate the students so they wouldn't protest. And it helped a lot because they were too busy drugging out to do anything for their country. But basically they just said, that's enough. We're going to go to a mercenary force. If we get these people to sign their life away, it's a contract, they can become a professional serf, and that's it. If they get killed, too bad. So all these wars now are being run by the corporations, not by our own government. They're all corporate wars. And it's very hard to stop this stuff because the corporations run everything. But they do it in secret. Now it's gotten even worse. They privatized all intelligence. So now we have Homeland Security comes in. It's basically, it was built by Marcus Wolf, who was the head of the East German Stasi, a very vicious guy. And, you know, the Stasi had underwear clippings on every underwear samples of every single person in East Germany for smell. They would freeze them. You heard about that, didn't you?
No.
Oh, yeah. So they had them in frozen banks so that dogs, they could take it out and track the guy, have the dogs sniff it. You could track them wherever they went. They never used it, but they had. Yeah, so the Stasi were vicious. So he was hired to set up Homeland Security by the Israelis. basically, they want to convert the United States to Gaza too, make it the world's biggest open-air prison camp, and then they want to kill us all off and have nothing, you know, no more goyim left. And they even want to get rid of the Torah Jews too, by the way. They hate them too. They don't like anybody that's a Torah Jew. I've got friends that are Torah Jews, and I have no problem with, never had. But it's these Talmudic ones. Most of the Talmudic Jews are secular, but they'll go to synagogue for special occasions, and they'll take this cold nidre oath once a year, which says it's okay. It's an oath where they're free to lie to goyim. You probably heard about that.
Sure, of course.
And there's three different.
It's all spelled out in the Talmud.
Well, if you want to know this, Michael A. Hoffman's a world expert on this. He's got the original Talmud, which is a secret document. They don't even allow most of the people to go to the synagogue to ever see the real one because it's so nasty. You know, talks about pedophilia being okay up to 8 years old, things like that. So basically, you know, these people worship Lucifer and the snake, the people at the core of this Khazarian Mafia thing. But they privatize all the intelligence agencies. They've gone deep underground. They've got 140 underground bases with high-speed tunnels crisscrossing the United States. I don't know for sure about Europe. They probably have them there, too. I know that Russia has some. But I do know they have them here because I know people have been in them, and I know for a fact they're here. And so now what's happened is the intelligence agencies – and no one wants to believe this, but I'll just tell you the truth. They've entered into agreements with alien ET, you know, cultures. There are some. And, you know, if you talk to Christian people, they say, oh, they're demons and stuff. I don't know. The ones that I've dealt with are bad. I'll just tell you that. And I've told you about some of the scrapes I've had. And, you know, Mark Nowitzki, too. See? So this is...
And as you know, I love your stuff, Preston, right up to the point where you start talking about ETs.
Well, you know, it's like my wife didn't believe in this stuff too. She had a little encounter with me, which, you know, if you have an encounter with one where you're attacked by one, you know, then it's there.
So, that tends to make you a believer.
I wouldn't have believed it otherwise. But anyway, so they have these underground bases. They've got these weird trees with whatever these things are. But they've formed what's called breakaway societies. So now what we have is we have these deep black operations or corporations. They're unacknowledged special access programs where you have to have like Ultra or Umbra or all these strange cute clearances to get into these things. But they're so compartmented, Jim, that you can take a company like Raytheon. Raytheon has some of these unacknowledged programs. So the CEO of Raytheon has no clue they're even there, and they would deny him if he asked them. So you have the CEOs of these companies, these defense contractors, don't even know about these programs in a lot of these underground bases. What's happened is they've gone rogue. Some of them have gone rogue, and they are the ones, they have taken over the NSA. The NSA is completely hacked. The Russians have everything from the NSA. The Israelis have everything. The Russians normally will only use it to blackmail, not to disclose. But who's ever disclosing all the stuff on Hillary Clinton and all the stuff, it's not the Russians. The Chinese have it too. The French have it too. So do the Germans. So do the British. It's a leaky sieve, but that's not who's doing it. Who's doing it are these private defense contractors, these little intel cells that have gone rogue. And they, for some reason, have gone off the reservation, and they want to take down, they're doing a lot of the right things, which is kind of strange to me, but they want to take down the Khazarian Mafia. Maybe they want to take down the Khazarian Mafia and take over themselves. I don't know what it is. But so far, if you think about, look at what happened with Snowden, if you look at all these leaks, the internet is the world's new Gutenberg press. In the last 5 years, there is so much information coming out. There's whole libraries that are digitized. Knowledge is going to destroy the Khazarian Mafia. We have all these alternative websites. 60% of them are run by Khazarian Mafia. It's misinformation sites to intercept this. You know what? They're failing. Because the ones that are peer intercepted are filled with total lies. Nobody goes to because nobody believes them. So they have to use limited hangout. They have to put anywhere from 60, 70, 80% truth in these websites to draw anybody. Then they deliver a bad payload. But now the users have become so sophisticated that what they have done is they'll pick and choose the truth nuggets and construct the truth in their head, the dots in their head. So they'll go to a dirty website, take the good stuff, leave the bad stuff, and say, well, I know where they're coming from, but I'm going to take the good stuff. So now what's happened is, I'll attribute a lot of this responsibility for this to you, because it goes back to your original books. When you were the first person I know of to create an open system where you invited people to do research. And when people would contact you and say, I don't agree with this in your book, it's wrong stuff, you'd say, hey, great, if you can give us the evidence, I'll readjust my thinking. And you had adjusted your thinking on some small things. You don't care where the facts come from, you'll look at them. See? So what you have done over the years, you've encouraged anybody that doesn't agree to go out and do some fact-checking, see what they come up with, and then whatever they discover, a lot of times they'll come back and say, you were right, but I found this, and you're taking it and putting it together. So you've had thousands of interactions with strangers from all over the world, and you created like a new group system.
Hey, and, Preston?
Yes.
You know, my first thing with Jim was Paul Wellstone. Yes. I've never heard of Jim until that. I looked at it, I saw his stuff, and I immediately said, this is right on. Yeah.
Well, he cracked the case. I can tell you a little bit more about that case. The pilot, Dick Connery, was a friend of mine. I went to grade school with him. I used to sleep over at his house when my parents were gone. And his father was a wealthy contractor, but he was a nurse, but he was also a pilot. And he was OCD. He was obsessive compulsive. He was very meticulous. Like I had lunch with him a few months before the accident happened, which was really, they blew the plane out of the sky. I'll tell you how that happened. But at that time, I had a piece of lint on my pants. And as I got up to walk away, he picked the lint off my pants. Now, that's the kind of guy he was. So anybody had the idea it was pilot error or he was a sloppy pilot, no way. This guy was meticulous. He did everything by the book. In fact, he was such a good pilot, Senator Wellstone always demanded that he flew the King Air. Now, the King Air was serviced near me, so I know all about the plane and everything else. I know what they did to it. They took that plane before it flew. They pulled the interior out. They sprayed it with nanothermite paint, and then they put the interior back in. This thing was all planned, and a white van, I believe it was, out in the country. When the plane came over, they had tracking devices on it. They pulled a tripod-mounted laser weapon, high-powered Raytheon weapon out of the back, aimed it at the plane, and hit it and knocked out the engines and went into the trees, exploded, went to the ground. But they couldn't put the fire out for a long time because of this thermite. They wanted all the evidence to be burned up. And of course, the FBI shows up on the scene at least 20 to 30 minutes before they could have gotten there. Which means they had
much more than that, Preston.
So they
were there by noon. And when I did a very conservative backward calculation, that meant they had to have taken off from St. Paul at the same time as the senator's plane, meaning they were heading for a crash site well before it had even taken place.
And then they tried to set up a false lead with his pilot. All the intelligence reports on his pilot was the guy was totally clean. You know, they were trying to dirty him up with a disc and all this crap. But the point is, that whole operation fell apart. Everybody knows what was done. Now, the garage doors, the electric garage doors in the area all opened during that time from that weapon that they fired. And the radio transmissions were all screwed up. They hear AM radio and stuff. So cell phones didn't work right. So what had happened with Jim over the years, and you're the only guy I know that said you've always been really open, and you fight with people, you argue with them, you can get really belligerent sometimes if they're wrong or if they're playing games with you, but you've always taken any contribution from anybody. You don't care who they are, if they're 80 years old, 10 years old, and you integrate it, you use it, and build so people feel like they can contact you, they can get somewhere. So what's happened is you have a number of convergences of factors. You got the internet, which is a new Gutenberg press. Never in history have we had access to so much information. Of course, the artificial intelligence is running. It's quite interesting, the scans that you can do. I mean, it's just incredible. So then they have the Game Boy. Remember all these computer games? You hook them up to your TV and stuff. These kids, young geek kids. You got kids that are into high school athletes and all stuff. Forget about them. But then you have the other kids, the geek kids, and this became a sport to them. They didn't play football. They didn't play soccer. They played computer. Okay, so these kids really got good at the games. But then they got bored with them. You know, they got, how many times can you play Auto Theft 5 or whatever it is? They got bored with it. They started going to the computer and doing research. Then they read your stuff, the conspiracy stuff, which has a draw. Conspiracy crime. Who killed Kennedy? What about CIA and drug dealing? There's a romantic James Bond. They see the James Bond movie. These kids transferred from all their little burnt out computer games to a big game in life called Crack the Conspiracy by the thousands. So they see the stuff on the internet, on these websites. You got rents.com, which is a fantastic site. You got What Really Happened, another one. You got VT. You got all these blogs, like your blogs, they go and they see this stuff, and none of it's in the mainstream. And then you have mainstream denying this stuff. Mainstream media still saying, to this day, they're saying Oswald shot Kennedy. Well, as you know, there's a law firm down in Dallas that has two floors. One floor is Team A of the CIA, retired CIA FBI guys, where they constantly are researching facts that the government killed Kennedy and covered it up, and they're giving out top secret documents proving that the government did it and the government covered it up. Then you got Faction B on the floor above them that's putting out all these stooge books like Norman Mailer, Oswald did it, and all the, so you have both of them. They eat lunch together, they laugh about it, but they get their paychecks. The paychecks are paid by a cemetery fund. When somebody dies, the laws require, every state has laws where you have to have a fund in perpetuity, to pay for the cemetery forever. Okay, well, at the time of the Kennedy assassination, they created a big, huge perpetuity fund that this law firm administers. It's a trust fund, and that's where they pay these guys from. So, if they get bored, they can transfer to the other team. I'm tired of proving that the government did it. I want to go on the other side. Okay, you got to wait till this guy retires and we'll move. So that's the game, is keep everybody fooled. And they say it's for national security. If we told the truth, our country would fall apart. That we're protecting everybody. We have to keep these things secret. Kennedy, the whole story with Kennedy. Kennedy had a back injury from World War II. When he became president, he had Admiral Berkeley, his doctor, who was a complete lying traitor, and he did examination on him, and he said, well, we'll give you these injections in your back. We'll give you some steroids. That'll take the pain away. He injects tuberculosis bacilli into him, giving tuberculosis the back. Then he tells him, hey, and of course, tuberculosis, and then he say, your adrenals are shrinking, which was a lie. The x-rays were fake. And then he said, we got to give you hormones, we got to give you adrenaline and all this. Your adrenals are going. Atrophy. We'll give you adrenaline. So, the side effect of adrenaline is hypersexuality. Of course, he came from a family where there was plenty of that. But so they got him hypersexual. Okay, then they just happened, the CIA just happens to be there with the mafia, offering up Sam Giancana's girlfriend, Judith Exner, Marilyn Monroe, all these presidential models, Mary Meyer, all these people. Mary Meyer gets LSD from
Timothy O'Leary.
Right. And liquid, puts it in his coffee. So they all have LSD. And Kennedy, they don't give him very much for it. Yeah, he likes this. And he Hoover, of course, has bugs there. He's photographing them all. And Hoover goes to Lyndon and says, Lyndon, their neighbors. He says, he's screwing that Mary Cord Meyer's wife. He said, you better tell Cord, you better get control of that ex-wife. Look what you do. Then he was screwing Ellen Romish, who was that German spy who they paid her to, be friendly with him. And though Hoover's, look, he's consorting with a Stasi spy. Look what this guy's, he's taking LSD, he's consorting. And now he's talking about getting out of Vietnam. This guy had gone off his rocker. They're bringing Marilyn Monroe to the White House, and Hoover's saying, look, he's screwing these women in the White House in a swimming pool.
Preston had laid, Lyndon had laid the foundation already in Los Angeles by forcing himself on the ticket so that he could accede to the presidency when Jack was taken out. Preston, I can't thank you enough for this absolute bonanza of information. Totally brilliant, sensational, really a wonderful contribution. And of course, you won't learn any of it from the colleges or universities of the United States today.
But you will get fired.
But you will get fired if you pursue it. I can't thank you enough for this, Preston.
Well, let me thank you, Jim, because you started this. It's a new sport. It's called Crack Conspiracy. You got millions of followers. And you don't even have to do anything anymore. You just sit back and watch the phenomena happen. Everybody's jumping into it. It's overriding the mainstream. The mainstream media is dying. The only thing that keeps it going is sex ads at night, big pharma drug ads, and soap operas and crap. It's falling apart.
Preston, sensational. I can't thank you enough.
All right. Mafia, every place they go, they start these wars. They destroy any country that's doing well. And then, as a means to thin the herd, kill as many as they can. And, of course, they have esoteric reasons why they like a lot of human suffering and death. But then they go in there and get all the natural resources for pennies on the dollar or nothing and share it with their crony corporate friends. So war is the best book on this was, of course, War is a Racket by Smedley Butler, General Smedley Butler, the most decorated war hero ever had, had two Medal of Honors. He was a Marine general. He told the truth. He couldn't do anymore. He said that the corporations were using the military to make money and protect their interests, and still doing it. So, we haven't had it. Even World War II was orchestrated. There was really no need for that. We built the Japanese up. built them into a military state to make money. The bankers did, and then they cut them off. The bankers started the Bolshevism. The bankers started Nazism. The bankers started Maoism. All these isms are started by them. The Soviet Union was a big experiment. It failed. So what they've been doing is using these dictator-type ships as an experiment to find out what's working. And the model they're using us now is a derivative based on artificial intelligence, where they've calculated all this out using multiple regression, come up with the ideal. They game everything. They have like a million different world situations going on different computers at the same time, and they game them all with different inputs, and they come up with the best composite. So basically, we're living in a completely managed situation.
And Preston, I have to say, this is not kind of information you get from academic institutions today. If anything, they're suppressing, they're giving an illusory impression of the way the world is together. You just cannot get this kind of truth from academic institutions, from professors, for all the kinds of reasons you've been suggesting.
Well, I 4 years ago, if I wouldn't have said any of the stuff that I'm saying tonight, it would have been an instant death sentence for anybody. Now, the whole thing's coming undone. They aren't doing that anymore. And now the intelligence agencies have turned against them. There's a split in the intelligence agency. Intelligence agents from all over the world are working together to destroy the Khazarian Mafia. There, all these leaks coming out are quite interesting. They can't stop. I just wanted to talk about the difference between fascism and super fascism. Now, basically, as you know, when we privatized the banking, Andrew Jackson fought it and stuff, but in 1913, banking in the United States, which is the creation of money and the distribution of it, was privatized. That's a very dangerous precedent. The bankers have a plan to privatize everything. So under George Bush, under all these various presidents, and Ronald Reagan did this too. He had this one executive order, 12333, which gave him the right to privatize things as the agents of national security. So during World War II, the tobacco corporations are privatized under national security. All these international corporations have all been privatized. Microsoft was privatized. Microsoft was going their own way and was very careful with security for their users. And, of course, the intelligence agencies went to him and said, listen, you're going to give us backdoors. You're going to put backdoors in all your software. And Gates said, no, I'm not. He said, oh, yes, you are. And he said, no, I'm not. So he left. About a month later, he gets sued in about 100 different courts under the antitrust laws. Then they go back in, drop down their business card and say, you want to talk about how you're going to help us with backdoors? Because we can get the monkey off your back. We can stop it all tonight. I guess maybe we can work something out. That's why Microsoft went bad. That's what they do to everybody. Of course, it's the old thing. So, you know, it's silver or lead. You know, the typical thing is they pull a contract out of one pocket. They set down a bullet, 50 caliber bullet on the other side of the desk. They said, now, I just work for these people. I don't do this. But here's what they're telling me is you can sign this contract and get all this money to build this and be our boy. You can become one of ours. Or you can get this lead when you least expect it.
An offer. They cannot refuse.
They really do that, see? Okay, so what happened in fascism, which is World War II, of course it happened earlier in Japan, but fascism is the merger of the state with the corporation. But regular fascism is where the state and the corporation are merged, but the state maintains control and runs the corporations for the political reasons of the state. There's the ultimate power lies with the state and the leader of the state. Super fascism is different. It's more sinister because with super fascism, you have the merger of the state and the corporation, but the corporation takes over the state and takes on the functions of the state and puts people in power in the state. It builds the state from its own revolving door people, so the state is nothing but corporate, stacked with corporate people. Now, that's what happened. We have no elected officials in this country anymore that represent the people. They all work for the state. As you know, like Cynthia McKinney said, if you're elected into Congress, you get a little visit from a representative of AIPAC. They have a little contract with all the fine print stuff. Basically, look, you know, we want you to join the team. Everybody else comes in there. They sign this agreement to put Israel first, even before the United States. But our interests are the same as yours, so it's not a problem. You sign this thing, we will make sure you get reelected. And that's why incumbents are reelected 97% of the time. But we're going to make sure. But what if I don't sign it? You don't want to know. You know, You don't want to know. Go find out what's happening to people who didn't sign it. So Cynthia McKinney said, no, I'm not signing it. She didn't. And of course, they redistricted. They spent millions of dollars getting an opponent that would take her out. They'll spend, they have all the money they want. They just go to the Federal Reserve, say, give me $15 billion. We get, you know, no problem. And if they don't have enough demand, they sell drugs. The CIA is the biggest drug dealer in the world. You know, if the drug laundering, the drug money laundering business was cut off, every major bank in Wall Street would go under in 1 month. And I got this from a high-ranking DEA guy. Anybody that wants to know about this can just get the book Underground Empire, Dennis Dale Rancente. It was so successful, every drug operation led to the CIA, but they shut it down. He would have put them all out of business. So basically, with super fascism, you have everything privatized. The corporations are running everything, but yet it's all through these doofuses they appoint in the government. So we think we can go to the government, elect new people in the government, tell them what they're going to do, all this. It has no effect because they're taking orders from these corporate heads like the Pilgrim Society, Council on Foreign Relations, all these privatized trilateral commissions. They're taking orders from these people that run these policy boards from that. So it's all totally deniable. If you go to these people and say, hey, quit wrecking our country, say, I don't know what you're talking about. Go talk to the president. He runs everything. The president doesn't run anything. Okay, so it's very sinister. Now, it gets even worse. They've privatized defense. You know, so it used to be the draft. People got drafted. That's why we had the protests for the Vietnam War. So they figured, this is no good. We can't have people riding the streets. You know, in Vietnam, you know about the rebellion that took place in Saigon in that one barracks with the blacks. We're tired of being, you know, cannon fodder, and they rebelled. And they actually had shootouts with their MPs and stuff. And they just said, we're not fighting anymore. And you know about the fragging. There were hundreds of officers fragged in Vietnam. They tried to cover that up. But these new lieutenants are coming out of West Point and say, we're going out tomorrow. We're going to get those Kong, and you're going to be point man. You know, they told the sergeant, you were going to rotate evenly. You're going to be point man. That guy said, no, we're not. We've been here. We're going home in a couple weeks, and we don't want to get killed. We know what it takes to be alive at this fire base. And the guy said, no, you're going to follow orders. At night while he's sleeping, somebody slips by, drops a grenade under his bed. Boom. Oh, he got hit with a mortar. That happened to hundreds of them because the whole thing went, they know that they'd lost total control. That's why they ended the war. Nobody wanted to fight anymore. It was ridiculous. So Nixon goes in there and bombs them, all stuff. That wasn't even working. So basically the war was lost at home. And of course, you know, Timothy Leary was giving out free LSD and everything. The whole deal with drugs and LSD was to try to demotivate the students so they wouldn't protest. And it helped a lot. Because they were, you know, were too busy drugging out to do anything for their country. But basically, they just said, "That's enough. We're going to go to a mercenary force. If we get these people to sign their life away, it's a contract. They can become a professional serf, and that's it. If they get killed, too bad." So all these wars now are being run by the corporations, not by our own government. They're all corporate wars, and it's very hard to stop this stuff because the corporations run everything. But they do it in secret. Now it's gotten even worse. They privatized all intelligence. So now we have Homeland Security comes in. It's basically, it was built by Marcus Wolf, who was the head of the East German Stasi, a very vicious guy. And, you know, the Stasi had underwear clippings on every underwear samples of every single person in East Germany for smell. They would freeze them. You heard about that, didn't you?
No.
Oh, yeah. So they had them in frozen banks so that dogs, they could take it out and track the guy, have the dogs sniff it, and you could track them wherever they went. They never used it, but they had. Yeah, so the Stasi were vicious. So he was hired to set up Homeland Security by the Israelis. Basically, they want to convert the United States to Gaza too, make it the world's biggest open-air prison camp, and then they want to kill us all off and have nothing, you know, no more goyim left. And they even want to get rid of the Torah Jews, too, by the way. They hate them, too. They don't like anybody that's a Torah Jew. I've got friends that are Torah Jews, and I have no problem with, never had. But it's these Talmudic ones. Most of the Talmudic Jews are secular, but they'll go to synagogue for special occasions, and they'll take this kol nidre oath once a year, which says it's okay. It's an oath where they're free to lie to goyim. You probably heard about that.
Sure, of course.
And there's three different.
It's all spelled out in the Talmud.
Well, if you want to know this, Michael A. Hoffman's a world expert on this. He's got the original Talmud, which is a secret document. They don't even allow most of the people to go to the synagogue to ever see the real one because it's so nasty. You know, talks about pedophilia being okay up to 8 years old, things like that. So basically, you know, these people worship Lucifer and the snake, the people at the core of this Khazarian Mafia thing. But they privatized all the intelligence agencies. They've gone deep underground. They've got 140 underground bases with high-speed tunnels crisscrossing the United States. I don't know for sure about Europe. They probably have them there, too. I know that Russia has some. But I do know they have them here because I know people have been in them, and I know for a fact they're here. And so now what's happened is the intelligence agencies – and no one wants to believe this, but I'll just tell you the truth. They've entered into agreements with alien ET, you know, cultures. There are some. And, you know, if you talk to Christian people, they say, oh, they're demons and stuff. I don't know. The ones that I've dealt with are bad. I'll just tell you that. He says, if we can get him angry, we get him to blow a fuse and make him look stupid, then it'll ruin the film so nobody will believe him. He'll discredit himself. He said, that's all we have to do. All we got to do is discredit him and our job is done. And he was part of this local Jewish organization. Now, they had a rabbi there too, even worse. Okay, so he's sitting there, they're getting ready. I'm sucking this all in, watching him. Plus, we had another guy over there that was following you, that was armed, stalking you that night. Remember that?
Yes.
Okay.
And you pointed him out to me. I wasn't aware until you made the offer.
Yeah, he was trying to follow you to his car. We had to take care of him on the way out of there. And, you know, he didn't get to your car, did he?
No.
He didn't get anywhere after that, did he? No. Okay, so then these guys are talking, and this old guy, well, first of all, you can't get your thing to work, and you're frustrated and stuff. And, you know, whatever they did, they got in through the Wi-Fi. That's what he said he was going to do. So they KO'd the program. But you got around. You got one of the older ones working somehow,
yes.
Right?
Yes.
Okay. And it was still pretty good. Okay, so then this old guy stands up and starts going on and on and on. And I nudged him in the shoulder. I said, sit down and shut up. You've had your say. So then he sat down. Okay, and then they started in on you. You know, you got through the most of the presentation, but they tried to interrupt him. I'd tell him to shut up. We want to hear this, you know. And finally, the guy in front of me looks at me hard, and I tell him, listen, buddy, let him talk. This is his time. So then they started getting a little scared. And then I had that one other guy, you know, that's, you know, 250 pounds, and he's so mean you don't even want to look at him, you know. He'll pull your teeth out with his fingernails. So he started eyeing them up and all this kind of stuff. And I got the idea to let them talk. So they backed off completely. Now, when we were down in Mayo and we had security for you down there, you remember they pulled the same stuff on you? That was some of the same people, same students. You remember how they started asking you questions?
I don't recall that at all.
They had two guys in the back, part of this Jewish organization, and they started asking you questions about the Holocaust and all this. And I went over there and told them to shut up, and they did.
You want to hear something ironic, Preston, is when they finally did ask me about the Holocaust, I was extremely explicit. I said, what I explicitly deny is that 6 million Jews were put to death in gas chambers using Zyklon B. And would you believe when it was later written about in the local paper, they said Fetzer was very vague about where he stood on the Holocaust. I mean, I could not have been more explicit.
No, but you said a lot more than that. You said it was a horrible thing, these people being kidnapped and put in these work camps and dying in them and all this. And you said even if the Red Cross figures of 190-some thousand were true, that's a horrible, horrible thing.
296.81.
Whatever, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah, so they totally twisted the whole thing. But here's the interesting part. When we get out of there, we sift through all the stuff. When all the intel finally comes in, it turns out that we ID all these people, but we find out they got a Mossad cell down there. About that time, I had a friend of mine. He wasn't a real close friend, but he was a friend of mine who was murdered. He was in a militia in southern Minnesota right after they started, these people moved in. This IDF Mossad guy comes in. He's murdered, okay? A little bit later, there's his family up in Bloomington, Minnesota. The guy that was producing the movie Gray State, murdered.
Yeah.
There's 12 murders after this crew comes in. They're all, I thought they were all linked to these people myself. We had no murders or any of this stuff until they came into town. Now, for them to be this rigid, where they are working the local media, they're threatening a bar restaurant owner that never heard a flea in his life, telling them they're going to shut his business down also because he has to talk. You never even mentioned anything about the Holocaust to this guy that owned the restaurant.
Right.
These people are so paranoid, they were inventing, confabulating all this crap in their mind. So they were in there. It was like life or death situation for them.
What has to be emphasized is we're talking about people on the staff and faculty at St. Olaf College and Carleton.
Which is supposed to be Christian religious schools where they
liberal arts school.
Yeah. But they were supposed to have Christian philosophy of, you know, freedom, all this kind of stuff. No, no. But the point I'm trying to make is these were desperate people in there, and they were working hard to try to screw you up. So there is no academic freedom outside of the university. And, you know, there's hundreds of cases just in the last year. And there, you know, there is no academic freedom inside the university. And as a graduate student, I can tell you there's no academic freedom. The only academic freedom I had was with my advisor. And that's because he was a good guy. And but he told me there was no academic freedom. He told me, if you want to get out of this place, you have to do this, 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 and this. You have to keep your mouth shut about this. You can talk to me, but you can't talk about this.
You know, Preston, I've been fascinated by your comparison of the Duluth campus and the Twin Cities. Now, it happened when I was doing the research on JFK that there was an associate dean in the graduate school who loved my work on JFK. And I think that that gave me a certain buffer on the Twin Cities campus. But when I founded Scholars for 9/11 Truth in December of 2005, which was only 6 months before I would retire the following June, they might not have been as receptive for my, you know, digging in to a whole other area and bringing together, again, a whole lot of experts to study it.
Well, Jim, I'll guarantee you that if you had been up there and gotten into Sandy Hook, I don't care if it had been, you know, the main campus in Minneapolis or the Duluth campus, you'd have been out of there so fast it'd been unbelievable, even if you didn't bring it into your classes. Because there's a new policy. Homeland Security goes around and delivers these NSL letters, these national security letters, and they put people on no work lists. And if you're going to cover a topic like that, they will go talk to faculty and say, this guy's a suspected terrorist. You got to get rid of him. We'll help you find a phony excuse. You cannot tell them the truth or you'll go to jail for 10 years. They let them read the letter. They take the letter back. We have witnesses how this is done. We know people are involved in it. So, yeah, there is no academic freedom. Right now, anywhere in the country, if you if you're a professor and if you teach this stuff on the outside, and if you're a small time, you might have tenure, but they'll get rid of you one way or the other. If you're a really big name person, they might leave you alone. But it's, you know, the thing is, it's starting to break, though. The Khazarian Mafia is falling apart. You know that I personally think we're going to go over a financial cliff sometime in the next period of months. And when the U.S. petrodollar dies, a lot of the prices are going to go up.
Hey, Preston, have you, on September 30th, China, the renminbi, the yuan that's going to join the reserve currency?
Right, yes.
Dollar. Have you looked into that?
Well, I was told that they're trying to downplay this, saying it's going to be a part of this special drawing rights, like a basket of currencies. But what it really means is the U.S. petrodollar will no longer be the main reserve currency of the world. It'll still be there, acceptable, but it's being pushed out nicely. Because, see, the reason the Chinese don't just drop it all is because they own tons of our debt. And if the value drops too fast, they'll get nothing. So what they're doing is they're buying up real estate in the United States like crazy, and they're buying gold and silver. But they're afraid of an immediate collapse, too, because if the stock market goes down too fast, they're going to lose their shirts, too.
Does the U.S. actually have gold, physical gold reserves? Is that, what's the inside on that?
Well,
is Fort Knox empty?
Yeah.
Fort Knox is empty. Well, no, that's not exactly true. There's gold in Fort Knox, but it's tungsten-filled gold.
Okay.
It's gold-plated tungsten bars.
I think it's, yeah, you know, it has the same density as gold, right. And you know about the big scandal where they shipped a bunch of U.S. mint stuff to China about 3-4 years ago, and the Chinese drilled through it and it was fake and they're furious. So I think there was a huge gold stash in the Twin Towers, you know, where the gold was taken out. Yeah. And claimed that it was lost and they collected on the insurance for it. I have conservative Christian friends who tell me, yeah, it's good to have a little gold and silver, but they believe the Bible prophecy where it says a bushel full of gold and silver won't buy a loaf of bread. I mean, they've already suppressed the price of gold and silver down to probably 1/5 of what it should be. You know, they have that's set in London, and the London bankers are in a quandary now because you know, they're losing money too. The Chinese have been buying up all this gold, and one of these days if the world shifts over to a new monetary system based on gold and silver and platinum and resources like corn and grain and things like that, bankers are going to be screwed.
You know, there's another thing going on is that the Federal Reserve has kept interest rates too low, and they're actually going to raise rates into a recession. That's got to be a sign that things are falling apart, you know?
Well, that's right. But see, the thing is in the last recession, 2008, the middle class and the older people lost 40% of their net wealth, 40%, and that did not come back. So there are a lot of people that lost 50, 60%, but most of it came back. But there are people that actually across the board lost 40% of their wealth. But because of the advanced mind control using the TV and all these waveforms and stuff, people have been put to sleep. You know, and one of their main strategies is to stress everybody from every direction possible, financially, job, this and that. So you're fighting so many battles, you don't have time to think about that. Look at what happened after 2008 when the interest rates in the banks dropped down to about 0%, maybe 0.01 or something. Old people up to that time had saved all their lives and were living off the interest off their accounts. Now they're spending down the principal. There is no interest coming in off their accounts. So there's been a remarkable drop in the standard of living. You have old people going back to work. The government wants to drive people out of their homes. They have this 2021. Have you ever heard of that? This Agenda 21?
Yes, yes.
And under Agenda 21, there will be no suburbs. You want everybody living in the city in 10 by 16 metal cartons stacked up, you know, like little tiny, like Japanese apartments. And they want to bulldoze all of the suburbs out, turn them into nature areas. So the real thing is they want to get depopulated areas so they can take the wood for forestry, take the natural resources. It's the same old thing, the Khazarian mafia.
It's a great pleasure to introduce a longtime colleague, both at Veterans Today and independently, Preston James, PhD, a social psychologist from a Big Ten university, who's going to address the importance of academic research in an era dominated by propaganda from the mass media, where academicians are failing to expose state-sponsored terrorism. He's an expert in this area. Preston, I'm so glad you could join us today.
Well, thanks for having me on, Jim. This is such a huge subject. We could have an ongoing conference for 6 months on this, because if you look at science, you know, medicine, a lot of the contributions that have been made, most of them have started in academia in Europe and Germany and Austria and places like that. That's the force that drives knowledge. And of course, the original term professor, it was a religious term, as you know, that it was basically seminarians professing the truth of God's word. But then they believed that all truth was part of that. Their job was to tell people total truth, scientific truth, truth about God, truth about loving your neighbor, ethics, everything. Of course, that all became secularized. Even the religious schools that were privatized lost all that, and they have, you know, rigid policies. There's no more academic freedom in any of the religious schools at all, the Catholic schools, the Christian schools. They're as dogmatic as you can find. And we'll talk about how that happened, because they were absorbed by Zionism. You know, they've been completely misinformed about Israel and the relationship to Palestine. This idea of the Christian schools that the Israelis are God's chosen people, and they use the term Jew. Of course, the term Jew wasn't even used in existence until 750 AD. Judaics comes from one tribe, one of 12 tribes. And as we know, the 97%+ of the people living in Israel that claim to have ancient heritage to the land, giving them the right to be there, do not. They're Ashkenazis or Khazarian converts to Judaism, you know, between 700 and 1200 AD. You know the story of that. And if anybody wants to know, you can look it up on the internet and get the history. So we have a situation where these Khazarian Ashkenazi Jews, were put into a situation. They were really molded into a race that doesn't exist, believing that they have to breed through their mothers. And it's not true. There is no such Jewish race as such. And even the Khazarians aren't purebred. And so the Holocaust, of course, as you know, made them very paranoid. And they've been all over the world setting up cells of control using every means you can imagine. And we'll talk a little bit about Northfield, you know, what happened down there. Because as you know, Jim, that was a real nightmare that we came through. Okay. So what we have is we have this very powerful group of a very well-organized group of Zionist Jews, but they're really not into the Torah. They're into the Talmud. They're really, you know, they really do not carry the heritage of the early Hebrew people. It's totally different. It's been completely warped. And what we have, these people have usurped power, become very powerful politically. They run the policy institutes. They have hijacked the Pentagon. They've hijacked the government. They've hijacked all of academia, the Christian schools, the secular schools. They're a force behind the media. And you have to ask yourself, why has this one group been able to dominate us and really run terror? Because all terrorism goes back to these people as a driving force. It's all part of their greater Israel plan. As you know, that they have this sinister plan to deploy terror all over the world so that as an excuse to build up and centralize the United States government and use it as a military arm to change the Middle East and to create this greater Israel. That's the dream. It's a psychotic dream, but it's real. So,
Preston, I must say that discovering the difference between Talmudic and Talmudic Judaism was one of the true revelations of my recent life. Because, you know, before 2008, when I gave my first political speech during a Ron Paul Freedom Rally on the 15th of April on the grass in front of the Capitol, the concept of Zionism really wasn't functional in my mind. I think that every American has to come to grips with the reality and have the conceptual framework appropriate to understand it.
Well, that's right. And of course, the big question is, why does this group, this artificial group, it's not a racial group. It's really not. Yeah, there's some, it's Ashkenazi and stuff, but they're really, it's a mixture of Mongols and Turks and whatever, if you really study it. And there's quite a sinister history to it. And they're very angry. They carry intergenerational anger toward the Russians, toward the Iranians. They blame them for destroying Khazaria. And they really blame, you know, the Gentiles too. So, but, you know, they themselves are Gentiles. That's the funny part. They don't know it. So here you have, you know, genetic study done at Johns Hopkins University by a Jewish MD, which you know about, and he comes up with the conclusion 97.5% of the people living in Israel that claim to have ancient blood have no Hebrew blood, come from Europe, and 80% of the Palestinians that live there do have ancient Hebrew blood and actually have ties, legal ties, to all the land, and there was no right for anybody to steal their land.
Just a comment on that, if I might, Preston.
Yeah,
we've just had a conversation with Kevin McDonald, who's done a great deal about the Jewish group strategy of inbreeding and, you know, benefiting themselves while encouraging other countries to become multicultural and to lose their own distinctive identity. But it seemed to me that Kevin was not convinced that the people who are occupying the lands of Israel actually aren't derivative from Judea. I'm convinced they are, and you cite the DNA studies from Johns Hopkins, which seem to me to be decisive.
Yeah.
While the term being a Semite is a linguistic distinction,
and
it applies to all the Arab lands, it turns out that those who are occupying Israel, ironically, are by and large not Semitic, but got to be the greatest practitioners of anti-Semitism in the world.
Well, that's right. They're two-faced. And the thing is you probably don't know this, but recently there was a top secret document in Israel where it was admitted that they have no Hebrew blood. They've admitted it to themselves, and that's why they wanted to go back and take the Ukraine. That's why Victoria Nuland went in there and staged the coup to put Poroshenko.
Because that is the country of their origin, the region of their origin.
And Poroshenko, they put him in. And, of course, that's failing. You know, he had that very strong, in Ukraine, had this huge business with tourism and tremendous tourism trade, which has been destroyed. So the country's going broke. But so if you look at this group, this every country in the world where these Judaics have been, they've been kicked out one way or another. And there's a whole lot of secret history about World War II. None of it is the way we've been told, as you know. And so we'll talk a little bit about that. But what I wanted to do is investigate, find out why these well-organized Jewish groups, there's a worldwide network of them, why they have so much power. They have access to Mossad intel files. The intel, Mossad has access, all of our NSA files are downloaded to Israel, Tel Aviv, by satellite. They have full access to all the NSA raw feeds. But what Israel doesn't know is they've been completely penetrated by Russian intel. The KGB, you know, set up Israel as their slave state. A lot of people don't realize it's the Bolsheviks that, you know, that staged the revolution in Russia in 1917, were financed by the British bankers, as were the Nazis. You know, and of course, you know that Hitler was a British agent the whole time. He was mind-controlled at Tavistock Institute. So the core problem always goes back to these Zionist bankers who really, they're not, they themselves are not Hebrew either. Most of them are German, but they're the great impersonators, but they played the role as a Hofjuden. They're the Vatican bankers, and they've gained a lot of power over the world. But basically what happens is they are the cutouts for the old black nobility families in Europe that really run things. These are the unspeakable families people do not dare talk about. It's very hard to get their names. If you do searches on the internet, they're there. They run things behind the lines. But basically where their money comes from, they own all the financial businesses and the big corporations. And the reason that these large corporations are so interested in starting wars is because they make money off wars, the defense contractors. And, of course, you know the big banks lend money to everybody. And if you look at what empowers the Zionists are nothing but cutouts. They're empowered by the private central bankers, the Rothschild banking system. The United States is a franchisee of it. The Federal Reserve is nothing but a franchise of it. People in the United States are being completely defrauded financially. In 1913, they passed the Federal Reserve Act, which is completely illegal, completely unconstitutional, Jim. And we're in a situation where they created real money, which is silver and gold-backed certificates, and they got rid of those bit by bit. 1971, Henry Kissinger, who's part of this Khazarian Mafia, which we'll talk about, which is the world's largest organized crime syndicate that is what the banksters really are. And because Henry Kissinger conned Richard Nixon into dropping the gold standard and the silver standard and went strictly to a paper dollar Federal Reserve note, there's nothing behind it anymore, as you know. Okay, but the deal was we made a contract with all the Mideast oil producers that we would provide protection for them through Israel if and through NATO, if they would promise that they would never accept anything but a U.S. dollar for oil. So that's up the United States dollar as a world exchange currency. But basically, our government's been printing so much, it's been watering everything down. The rest of the world right now, China, Russia, and many, many other nations are building huge financial firewalls against the United States to destroy the Federal Reserve and destroy the U.S. dollar, and it is coming. So, you know about the BRICS, the AIIB, the Chinese have set up their own electronic SWIFT money transfer system. And then you have the new Silk Road developed as World War II, whom we shipped weapons to during the whole war against the Japanese, was totally trustworthy, turned on them at the end, divided Vietnam into two countries, shipped weapons to the South, and started the war, just like we did in Korea. You'll never have a class on that, Jim. See, it's not allowed. So you'll never have a class on the influence of Zionism, the cutouts for the bankers. The reason the Zionists have so much power in this country is because they do the dirty work of the banksters. The banksters like them. They're the front people for them. You know, they maintain their system for them. And they're greatly rewarded for it, too, financially. They get the game is the people that really run things, I call them the establishment hierarchy. There's probably, you can count them on a handful. I call them wrinkled up old guys in wheelchairs or this select few. They make these decisions. You have everything is organized into a pyramidal hierarchy, and you maybe have one or two or three people at the top that call the shots. Whatever they say is law. Some guy has a bad day, fights with his wife or his kids, and he thinks, damn it, we're going to get rid of all the guns. And he calls up his lieutenant and says, that's it, new policy, no more guns in America. So then they immediately, okay, they go to the Federal Reserve, the U.S. Treasury, they maybe go to black drug operations, but they appropriate maybe $20 billion, and they hire NGO groups to go to every state. They hire lobbyists. The whole machinery comes into play because one guy had a bad day, had a fight with his wife, and decided to set a new policy. Now, I know that sounds stupid, but that's how it works. And, you know, I've had contacts with people very high up, and this is what I find out, that it's very banal. How these policies are set have no rhyme or reason to them. They have certain key agendas, like anything that will help globalize the world, take away our national sovereignty, they'll approve. So what the people that are running our government are doing it on the basis of policies that have been set by these top policy guys, and what they want is they want to degrade the United States, convert it into a third world nation like Mexico. They've signed secret agreements. Their secret clauses in every trade agreement, like NAFTA, had secret clauses where they said United States, Canada, and Mexico are one state, and that's why we're not going to enforce the borders. Now, they're still enforcing them with Canada, but they're not allowed to enforce them with Mexico. Part of the secret clauses are the sanctuary cities. This has all been signed and agreed to. So in order for us to get rid of this, we have to get rid of the people making these policies, which is the Khazarian Mafia top officials. Anybody who wants to know that can study it. In the last 2 years, we've broken it all open for the first time. Normally, 3 years ago, if you even mentioned the word Khazarian Mafia, you'd have been dead by the next day. They'd send somebody out and shoot you right in your bed. That's how much they wanted to keep it quiet. Now it's an open secret. The Khazarian Mafia is being attacked by all sides. As you know, Putin has been a strong ally of Syria and Iran for years. Neither country started any war for many years. I think 200 years for Iran, isn't it? I don't know how many for Syria. And, of course, Iran was attacked by Iraq at our bequest because we, you know, used Saddam as a puppet. That was another Israeli operation. But, what happens is these policymakers appoint doofuses at every level in the government. They control the elections. They fake the voting. They vote dead people. They do it. John Kennedy actually lost the election to Richard Nixon. Richard Nixon was furious. But the reason that everybody liked Kennedy so much is because he went against the grain. The mob supported him in Chicago. They thought he was going to take care of them. He didn't. He put Bobby in there as U.S. Attorney General. Bobby turned on all of them. And that's one of the reasons they wanted to assassinate him. They did all kinds of things to dirty him up and entrap him. And as many ways as they compromised Jack Kennedy, you know, he was still a good president. He was always a true American right to the very end. So that's what we need. People are hoping Trump might be like this. I don't know. We don't know. It's too soon, but, you know, we'll just have to wait and see. But the Khazarian Mafia is under fire. So when the Americans created ISIS, as you know, it's strictly an American Central Intelligence Agency mercenary force supported by Israel, supported by Turkey, supported by Saudi Arabia, financed a lot by Saudi Arabia. It's completely artificial. When we went over there and they have these training camps, they pick up street urchins off the street, like in Saudi Arabia, little kids that are abandoned, take them in training camps, and they mind control them for 15 years, show them all kinds of movies. And you know, they're complete zombies by the time they're done with them. And they will blow themselves up. They will do anything they're told. That's what they create. So the mercenaries come in and train them and run them. Well, of course, the plan was to get rid of Syria, take it Syria down, then use that as a stepping stone, get rid of Iran. They're not afraid of Iran for nukes. They're afraid of Iran because they're so strong. And the Israelis hate the Persians. They want to get rid of them. So when that happened, of course, Putin has billions and billions of dollars invested in Iran and Syria, and he came to their defense. He was invited to help Assad. He went in there under international law legally and helped him. Now, the United States is in Syria right now. They have no legal right to be there. They never had any legal right to be in Iraq or any place. You know. So basically what happened was Putin's military has pounded him, and he's got special ops on the ground. He's got air power there. He's got cruise missiles. He's got everything. And he literally has pounded ISIS. Another month or two, they're not even going to exist. So what you have is you have a situation where now the United States is starting to bomb ISIS to look good to the world. And so the United States has turned it into a disposal operation where they're killing their own. All these CIA mercenaries and these special op guys are all going to be murdered. None of them are probably going to come out of their alive because the current administration won't allow that. We always kill our black ops when we're done. And it's getting to the point now where people know SEAL Team 6, they were murdered. So this is the kind of people you have determining educational policy. That's why there isn't any. Now, I'd like to get into Northfield, if I can, just to give a good example. And we're going to talk about operational realities. And you know, I was right there, so people can say whatever they want. I was there. Okay, as you know, when you come to Minnesota, there's some pretty serious people here that take care of your protection, as you know. Jim, you know that, right? We watch out for you up here. And I'm not talking little babies. I'm talking some pretty tough individuals. Okay, so when you went to Northfield, we'd done, you know, intelligence work. We scoped the place out for the entrances and everything and, you know, the whole usual stuff. And we had, I was part of that three-man team, as you remember.
Just to provide a sketch for the audience, Preston, I was invited to come to Northfield as part of a series being organized by the owner of a bar called the Contented Cow, Norman Butler. He wanted me to speak about Sandy Hook, about the Boston bombing, about JFK, about 9/11. And I was immediately assailed as a Holocaust denier by members of the faculty and staff at St. Olaf's College and at Carleton, which was incredible, given that they both have a reputation for being liberal arts colleges where you should be open to freedom of expression, freedom of research, freedom of inquiry. But they undertook a campaign of vilification against me, and eventually the atmosphere became so threatening that Norman Butler had to call it off because his own staff, felt such a sense of anxiety. Now, in this
context, they threatened to ruin his business, though. They threatened to ruin his business.
Oh, yeah, they did, absolutely. It was completely outrageous. So Kevin Barrett thought this was outrageous and we ought to do something about it. And because he has a nonprofit, he was able to contact the library to obtain a conference room for me to speak. So I came to Northfield, nevertheless, in spite of all the animosity, which had become a huge subject of discussion in the local newspaper and elsewhere, and spoke on Sandy Hook at the Boston bombing at the conference room in the library. This is the event of which you speak and the background against which it occurred.
Which Dr. Kevin Barrett set up, which was it was the Israeli Islamic Alliance.
Yeah,
I don't want to give the impression that you know all Jews in this country are screwballs. No, actually, it's a small minority of them. But they're dangerous individuals, and we'll talk about why. But there's, right now there's a big split in the Jewish community. A lot of the American Jews are sick of all of Netanyahu and all this like CUDA stuff, and this boycott, divest, sanction is created a huge split. Even in the Mossad, there's people in the Mossad turning against them. But so we get down to Northfield, and we did a complete security check. We had the whole thing scoped out, and we had people down there helping us too, watching people coming in and typing them and everything. So I end up sitting next to these guys, which gave up a lot of nonverbals. You can tell by people how they get nonverbal signals and get off that they're deceptive. So I sat next to this guy. It turns out he was a college professor from one of these colleges you're talking about, supposedly a Christian college. Okay. He has two guys there with him. One is runs a security system at one of the universities. The other guy is an IDF guy, a Mossad agent. He's got three students, and he's got one old guy about 70 years old, and they're sitting there huddling before the thing. But what he didn't understand is I was sitting right behind him, and I had a hat on, and I had very good hearing. The hat was pushing my ears for it, so I could hear every word. And he's saying, okay, now what we got to do is this Fetzer guy, he's a Holocaust denier, but he's not here to talk about it, but we got to draw him out. So what we got, first thing we got to do is, you, Max, you got to stand, this old guy, you stand up and ask stupid questions and waste time and all this kind of stuff. And after he gets frustrated, wait till he's frustrated. We're going to screw up his electronic stuff. We've got somebody who's got the audio-visual stuff remote controlled. We'll take care of that. So-and-so's got that covered. Turns out that guy was an expert in that. Okay, as you know.
I couldn't get my computer to work.
No. But they were doing that through the Wi-Fi.
I could only get an old program to play on someone else's computer, Preston.
Because they were working your computer through the Wi-Fi. I heard them talking about how they're going to do this. Okay, so then the guy says, the student says, okay, you bring up this. And at the end, when he's angry, when he's real frustrated because the thing is his computer won't work and this, he said, and the one guy says, well, I might be able to keep him from even having any visuals. And that'll really frustrate him. So then when you see him really getting angry, then you bring up the Holocaust, and he's whispering to him what to say, which where they're going to run this railroad all the way from China through Russia to the Mideast and then to Europe, and it's going to totally revolutionize. All the power is going to shift to that area, Eurasia. That's why Brzezinski had the great chessboard plan where he wanted to go over there and take this over. He's recently announced he's abandoned it. That Russia basically checkmated the Khazarian Mafia in Israel in the Mideast. All these wars in the Mideast wars were all staged. None of them were justified. They were all based on lies, false premises. Okay, so if you want to understand why there is absolutely no academic freedom of any kind. And that's my hypothesis tonight, and I'm going to tell you why. My research technique that I use, I don't know if I've ever talked about this, but I do participant observation. I go get involved at every level. And so that's the only way you really find out what's going on the street. And I've infiltrated all kinds of stuff that I won't talk about. Well, we have, you remember President Woodrow Wilson, the guy that signed the Federal Reserve Act in 1913. In his book that was published in 1913, it's called The New Freedom. There's a quote which is very important. He said, since I entered politics, I have had men's views confided to me privately. Some of the biggest men in the U.S. in the field of commerce and manufacturing are afraid of somebody, are afraid of something. They know that there is a power somewhere so organized, so subtle, so watchful, so interlocked, so complete, so pervasive that they better not speak above their breath when they speak in condemnation of it. He was talking about the banksters. They have a worldwide organization, the Rothschilds. They have their own intelligence. They hire all kinds of agents. They specialize in murder by knife, gun, poison, all kinds, setting up accidents. You know, they were the original founders of Arkansas, making murders look like natural deaths. So really, all of the intelligence agents in the world were basically financed by central banking system, the Rothschilds. In the United States, all our intelligence agencies were set up under the British model, like the intrepid Sir William Stevenson came over and set most of them up, and they all answered originally to the British intelligence system, the Queen. And technically, we're still operating under that model. But these intelligence agencies, like the CIA, the FBI, the U.S. Treasury, they all work for the banksters, and they're there to protect their interests. So we really have a cabal of banksters creating money from nothing, charging us usury, pernicious usury to use our own money, which, of course, is illegal in many of the Islamic countries, and that's why they want to destroy them. They go after any country that will not use their banking. You know, and so that's what starts basically the wars. Two things: destroy the fiat banking, so they have to use Rothschild banking. That starts the war. Or if any country is becoming too powerful, like Libya was developing a gold coin system for all of Africa. They had a water system was going to revolutionize. It was going to turn into one of the greenest countries in the world. People were happy. Gaddafi. Was taking care of young people, health care, you know the story. He was doing a good job, so they had to get rid of him. It was Hillary Clinton that did that, of course.
I remember how stunned I was when the reports came out that the first act of the alleged rebel group in Libya was to found a new central bank. Right. And Hillary's emails, the ones being declassified, have revealed the actual reason for the attack on Libya has nothing to do with Gaddafi abusing the people, as you're implying. On the contrary, is sharing the wealth of the nation with them, national health care, public education, warehouses stocked with food. Anyone with a health problem that couldn't be dealt with in Libya would be flown anywhere in the world, all expense paid by the government. But rather, because Western banking interests, read that Rothschild, were upset with the gold dinar, and that the French wanted to preserve their influence over Africa as their neo-colonial preserve.
Exactly. Now, here's the thing. This network we're talking about, the Israeli firsters that control the universities, they control the policy boards, they control the academic curriculum totally in the private schools, in the public universities, and in even the religious universities. They control it all, and they do it through various ways. And we ran into it head on down in Northfield, Minnesota. And we're going to talk about that in a minute and how we dealt with that. And what we uncovered there when we ripped the thing open, it went all the way back to Israel, Jim, as you know. So, but the reason these groups have this power is because, and you would think here they are working against the interests of the United States. They should really be arrested. They should have to register as a foreign agent group. All these people that harassed you down at Northfield, should have been arrested right there, but they're not. So you have to ask yourself why. Why can somebody like Dr. Kevin Barrett, be sanctioned for doing nothing wrong, you know, or other professors that are continually being fired for speaking up? Why is there no academic freedom when you have these people that are actually going against the rules, that are doing things in their classes that are against the United States? See, the thing is if you do something that's politically correct nowadays, politically correct is really Bolshevism. It's against the interests of the people. If you teach that pornography is great, and if you teach that any kind of deviance is good, and anything that breaks down the society, then it's fine. You can, I remember when I went to a university, we had a communist professor there, and he would say all kinds of horrible things during the Vietnam War, no problem at all. And if the kids protested outside, protested the war, they would be sanctioned or kicked out of school, but he could do anything he wanted because he was a Bolshevik and because he was Jewish. I thought that was very strange. See? So if you support what the establishment wants, if you have a role that favors the establishment, say, well, how do these groups that go around and control and suppress any kind of free discussion, like these Jewish groups that go around and prevent any discussion of false flag terror, Sandy Hook being a hoax, Boston bombing being a fake false flag, all these fake shootings, or the real ones that are real actual mind control? Why don't they want any of that discussed? You would think that if they were true Americans and citizens that cared about this country, they want it discussed, but they're not. They're dual citizens, and they actually favor Israel first, and they see it very important to fulfill these policies that our establishment hierarchy wants, because that way they're empowered. So what we have is we have enforcement of these policies set on what curriculum is going to be. All university curriculum is set by policy boards, private policy boards that have meetings. I'm not going to give you the names of them, but they're almost all linked to Jewish, these dual citizens, and PNAC and all the top neocons. They're all involved in setting educational policy. It actually goes back, if you want to really get technical about it, to the early 1900s, when they wanted to centralize education and run it out of Washington so that they could control it. That's what they're doing. So there is no academic freedom. You slip through the cracks. I remember up in Duluth when you started, if you'd been down at the main campus in Minnesota, they would have jumped on you for some of the stuff you did at the end of your career. In their view, your investigations were outrageous. Now, of course, I was one of the first people to get hold of your book, that first one you wrote, Assassination Science. I was so shocked by it that a professor could do a scientific study. And, of course, the first objection would be is, some professor can't know anything about covert operations stuff. You see, but your answer was, you right up front said, here's what I can do and here's what I can't do. In the areas you didn't specialize in, you brought in the top specialists. So it was impossible to criticize because you had the top forensic guys, top medical guys, and you put it all together. Now, that had never been done. I was shocked. So I called you up on the phone and talked to you. I said, this is fantastic, And so then the other two came out. I call it the trilogy. But those three books, nobody had ever done a scientific study. I mean, I like Jim Marr's work. I like all of that, But And there's been other people, but no one ever did a scientific study. And the thing about your stuff was it totally, absolutely shredded it shredded the government cover up totally. So I ended up with two things from your books. Number one, the government, the CIA did it. And I found out later, I talked to people involved. I know who did it. I found out that the government covered it up. I found out the government's still covering up. I think the research you did that shocked me the most, the two things was the fake brain x-rays, which, you had the top medical expert in the world that helped you with that. And the other thing was the Pruder film being so fake. When you start looking at how much fakery was done in this Pruder film, two things are obvious. One, they did a terrible job, and two, they didn't care. They were so arrogant, they just didn't care. So much of this was slop work, and it's easy to discover if you have the right people. Well, see, you brought in, some film expert from Australia. You had some of the top eggheads in this stuff around, and your research is bulletproof, see? So I think, for me, that changed my whole orientation to it, because before it, I'd try to reason through it, but then I realized you can go after this stuff scientifically. You can use reasoning, and of course, because you taught logic for so many years, when people would try to intercept you and shut you down using the various things like straw man arguments, like, you're on to every single one of them. You'd rip them a new one in seconds. So I always enjoyed it. So the reason we have no academic freedom is because all academic curriculum is set by policy boards, hidden boards in smoke-filled rooms in D.C. and New York City and Chicago. And they decide what can be talked about or not. So you will never have any classes on the Federal Reserve Bank, fiat money, why it's not real money, and how come they get to charge us interest for doing nothing, and who are the owners of the Federal Reserve? Why are they all foreign-based families? Why is that? See, you'll never have a class on that, or false flag attacks, or Sandy Hoax. You'll never have a class, or you'll never have a class on deep black covert operations, or Dulce, New Mexico underground base. You'll never have any of that, see? These are the most important subjects we have, or the Vietnam War, why it was fake, or you'll never have a class on why Ho Chi Minh, one of our biggest allies,